And Laura's work is, I hate to use the trite word, amazing, but it is, it's an analytical, scholarly, extremely scholarly master's thesis on pro-anemia websites. But what it really does is it builds on an existing critical feminist analysis of femininity by bringing together so many different frameworks of critical analysis. So she brings in a Marxist analysis and looks at, I won't tell you what she does, she'll tell you what she does. But
I can speak for myself.
And brings in, and really importantly, brings in a really, really key anti-racist analysis, and then also theorizes both the economy and the state, situates this analysis within all of those pieces in a way that turns it into what I would say much more effective and powerful form of social justice analysis, in which we can really see what's happening and where the fronts and strategies and opportunities are for change. And it's a very profound dialogue.
Thanks, Zoe. And I like to start off every presentation with Beyonce's video, Pretty Hurts. So I hope those speakers will work. They worked last time I was in here. But this came out like right when I started writing this thesis. It worked last time. What about on the computer?
I'm just going to pause there for a second. We're having some feedback issues.
Why don't you turn that up and we can turn these down.
Okay, we can give it a shot.
You can advance. So I'm just going to take you through some of the chapters of my thesis. The cultural production of the feminine body, next slide. The pro-anemia movement as an extension of capitalism, next slide. The contradiction of control, next. And the pro-anemia websites as a cultural resistance movement. So, go ahead. So the methodologies I used was the feminist Marxist lens. Next slide. And I did secondary textual research and and a textual analysis of the pro-anemia website. So I went through as many and pro-anemia is the promotion of anorexia and bulimia, and they're usually in websites. So I went through as many websites as I could and analyzed the rhetoric and discourse that are used throughout these websites. Next slide. And my thesis is also an autoethnography. So I took my journals from when I was little, when I looked like that, and I analyzed them through the lens of this theory, and I look at the rhetoric that I used back then, and a lot of it lines up perfectly with what I'm talking about now, and it's kind of creepy. And I won't go into that super a ton today, but just to let you know what I did. So the cultural production of the feminine body. Next slide. Femininity is constructed out of difference. It's a knowing construction that's publicly performed. One can never fully achieve the Western ideal feminine body. Therefore, women must constantly exert their labor power in order to, in the service of femininity. So I'm positioning women as laborers of femininity within a Marxist capitalist sense. David Harvey says that capitalism requires of its laborers a certain amount of skilling, de-skilling, and reskilling of powers of laborers. As laborers of femininity, women have developed a very unique cultural skill set. These skills have been culturally constructed into the very meaning of what we consider to be a woman. So in my opinion, women are grossly exploited cultural workers. They're exploited for the labor of creating the ideal feminine body. So when I think about this, I think of the classic smoky eye. So we're taught very specific ways to put on makeup, apply it to our bodies, for very specific occasions, very specific seasons, different types of the day. So this is a ritualized and repetitive consumption of materials, makeup, that directly benefits the capitalist system because capital is constantly reinvested throughout this process. Next slide. So Marx is constantly talking. He says that the more productive the working class is, the poorer they collectively come due to an increase of surplus value. And the same is true with femininity. Next slide. David Harvey says that the perpetual shifting that occurs within the capitalist mode of production ensures that the definition, the requirements, definition of skill, and systems of authority, divisions of labor, are never stabilized for long. So the more women that are working towards this ideal feminine body, the harder it becomes to achieve. Next slide. Shut up, Tim. In order to ensure the ever-growing and shifting of capitalist markets, niche markets are created. So niche markets serve capitalism by targeting and marketing to a very specific population or interest group. And this happens with women's bodies as well. Various parts of women's bodies are identified as problem areas, and they're propagated along with products claiming to target these problem areas. So for instance, I didn't know that I had cellulite on my body until I found a product that was sold to me in order to remove it from my body. So femininity has become much more nuanced. It's now not just like what we're putting on the body, it's read as the body. Next slide. So now a woman's skill set is essentially an act of discipline. Women must regulate not only what they wear, how they act or even feel, they need to discipline the most basic of biological needs. Barkey says, the innocent need of the organism for food. In order to be considered skilled, one must deny one's body of food altogether. In order to perfect the art of embodying the cultural ideal, one's appetite must be monitored at all times and governed by an iron will. So this kind of behavior is grounds for the diagnosis of anorexia nervosa or bulimia nervosa. So here are the diagnostic and statistical manual of mental disorders criteria for bulimia and anorexia. And I've underlined some of the things that I think are the most interesting. So sense of lack of control. Self-evaluation is unduly influenced by body weight and shape. Intense fear of gaining weight or becoming fat. So when I read these, I think, okay, so what woman in our society doesn't have this at some point or another? Next slide. So are the majority of women preoccupied with their weight disorder? Or are we ignoring that for most people in our culture, slenderness is indeed equated with competent self-control and intelligence? According to a study performed by Peter Gasser, over half the females surveyed between 18 and 25 would rather be run over by a truck than be fat. And I don't know how it would be to be run over by a hamburger truck, but I imagine it would be worse. In fact, the ideal has become such an established part of our cultural norm that there's been an entire movement created to encourage and support one another in the pursuit of what's called an anorexic and bulimic lifestyle. Which brings me to the pro-anemia movement as an extension of capitalism. Go ahead. So anorexic and bulimic people have perfected their skills to a science. Calories must be calculated, those taken in as well as lost, weight closely monitored, body mass index calculated, recorded and analyzed throughout the day. Yet pro-anemia members take this to the next level. They perfected very literal skills in order to lose weight, keep it off, how to keep from fainting, how to ward off hunger, and most importantly, how to hide one's lifestyle from doctors, parents, and friends. Next slide. Sandra Lee Barkey depicts anorexia as the modern-day hysteria, stating that these pathologies are the crystallization in a pathological mode of widespread cultural obsession. Therefore, I argue that pro-anemia movement is the mode of production wherein this cultural obsession is acted out. If women are made to labor for the ideal feminine body, then pro-anemia is the mode by which the ideal femininity is produced. Pro-anemia is an intense physical manifestation of our cultural anxiety surrounding female bodies. So on many of the websites, they talk about Anna as a religion, Anna being anorexia. And so they'll have the Anna Creed, Anna Commandments, and Anna Psalm. And so the creed starts out, I believe in control, the only force mighty enough to bring order to chaos that is my world. Commandment says, if you're not thin, you aren't attractive. The Psalm starts out, strict is my diet, I must not want. Next slide. So many of the points expressed throughout the Anna Commandments and Creed are covertly expressed throughout the mainstream Western culture. As a culture, we have become accustomed to being constantly inundated with the ideal of thinness. So perhaps this is why the pro-Anna sites are so shocking. It's because they compile all the covert messages that society tells women about their bodies into a very overt list. Pro-anemia is the concentration of the values our culture places on women's bodies and the mental consequences faced by many women who strive to embody the myth of the ideal femininity. Next slide. Women are taught to exist outside of need. Therefore, pro-ana members remove the need from their bodies altogether, saying, I've trained myself to enjoy feeling hungry. Society teaches women to be thin, therefore pro-ana will not only be thin, they will be just bones, no disfiguring flesh. Women are taught not to want, pro-ana say, blessed are the starving, for they shall teach us not to want. Susan Bordeaux defines anorexia as a remarkably overdetermined symptom of some of the multifaceted and heterogeneous distresses of our age. Then I argue that pro-anemia movement is the overdetermined mode by which these heterogeneous distresses are articulated. Pro-anemia movement is unintentionally bringing awareness to the absurdity that is the myth of the feminine body, feminine ideal, as they expose the contradictions of what it means to be a woman within Western culture. Pro-ana is an inconspicuous threat to cultural femininity. Yeah. So the perfect worker is one devoid of basic humanity. In Pro Anna and Mia, participants have already erased need and want from their bodies. David Harvey says that capital requires educated and flexible laborers, but it refuses the idea that laborers should think for themselves. While education of the laborer appears important, it can't be the kind of education that permits free thinking. So individualization is a perpetuating force. We need to understand that this experience of lack of control and feelings of guilt and unworthiness as culturally based, wide shared experiences and not one of individual pathology. This is where I see the door to Pro Anna and Mia as a cultural resistance movement, but I'll return to that later because I want to focus on the contradiction of control. You can go next slide. So femininity is a balancing act. Wow, this color is really coming. You're either a slut or a prude, a bitch or a pushover, too fat, too thin. There's very little middle path to being a woman. Next slide. So society tells women that they must have a perfect body. Yet Barkey says to succeed in the provision of a beautiful or sexy body gains women attention and some admiration, but little real respect and rarely any social power. A woman's effort to master the feminine body will lack importance just because of her activity. And her activity partakes in the general depreciation of everything female. So we allow women very few avenues through which to be publicly acknowledged. One of them is physical appearance. People commenting on the weight that I had lost became a positive reinforcement and the attention that I craved but rarely received. So it's no surprise that women turn to eating disordered behavior in order to receive public affirmation. So women are ridiculed and dismissed for the triviality of their interest in such trivial things as clothing and makeup, but they're also dismissed if they refuse to partake in it as well. So female politicians are more often evaluated on their appearance rather than their actual intelligence or competence. And what proves this to me is the fact that there's a HillaryUgly.com. The arguments about Hillary rarely center around her actual platform. Most of the time they're talking about how she looks haggard or she's old, etc. But there would never be a BillUgly.com, even though his many public transgressions, right? So next slide. So, the state literally has sanctioned control over women's bodies. Just in the last year, if we look at legal birth control battles, safe access to abortion, especially in Texas, the threat of violence under rape culture, how many different campuses there have been rapes without any repercussions. Women's control over their bodies has literally been taken away at the state level. Amy Liu, in her memoir about her struggle with anorexia, says that the sense of accomplishment exhilarated her and spurred her to continue on. She said it added a sense of purpose and shaped her life with distractions from insecurity. The constant downward trend of the scale somehow comforted her and gave her visible proof that she could exert control. So eating disorders are an avenue through which women are able to gain a sense of control over their bodies. So this really isn't an individual problem. It's a state-sanctioned one. Next slide. So there's a myth within our society that eating disorders only affect rich white women. Stephanie Covington Armstrong is the first black woman to write about her struggle with an eating disorder, and she identifies three factors that affect the rate of reporting among minority women. Underreporting of the problems of the individual, under and misdiagnosing in the part of the treatment provider, and a cultural bias of the diagnostic and statistical manual. Perfectionism, like control, is often seen as a precursor to women's vulnerability to an eating disorder. Yet, internalized oppression can lead to perfectionistic thinking, especially in women, queer people, people of color, working class people, as they unconsciously fear they are inferior. Perfectionism at its base is about minimizing shame. Shame is inevitable with our current construction of femininity. Shame can be intensified working class women and women of color. According to Barkey, the disciplinary project of femininity is a setup. It requires such radical and extensive measures of bodily transformation that virtually every woman who gives herself to it is destined to fail in some degree. Thus, a measure of shame is added when a woman senses that the body she inhabits is deficient. Many women without the time or resources to provide themselves with even the minimum of what such regimen requires, a decent diet, therefore there's an additional source of shame for poor women. The burdens that poor women bear in this regard aren't merely psychological, since conformity to the prevailing standards of bodily acceptability is a known factor in economic mobility. Brené Brown is a shame researcher, and she says that shame feeds off of silence, secrecy, and judgment. Therefore, we've created a culture where eating disorders among low-income women and women of color thrive and grow exponentially. The myth that only upper-class white girls are affected by eating disorders further increases the shame a disorder one's not supposed to have, creating an added barrier to receiving treatment for a life-threatening condition. And anorexia has the highest mortality rate of any mental disorder. Next slide. When medical personnel and feminist theorists theorize about women with eating disorders as victims of society, I believe that they're participating in the systematic removal of women's control over their own experiences, identities, and bodies. So women with eating disorders are cast, especially by feminist theorists, as victims of society, as objects with no agency over their lives, actors who are unable to be self-aware agents. Ruth Wilson Gilmore defines agency as the human ability to craft opportunity from the wherewithal of everyday life. I believe that women with eating disorders are using their agency to attempt to create opportunity for themselves within a society that holds women to impossible standards. Which brings me to pro-anemia websites as a cultural resistance movement. At its base, I see pro-anemia as women organizing around a shared cultural identity. Next slide. So Stuart Hall identifies two different types of identity formations, reactionary and revolutionary, and I believe that pro-ana is both. Reactionary identities are formed at a time which in a group of people, where a group of people with the same previously established cultural identity came together in a new way, usually around a reaction to a specific injustice. Pro-anemia formed in reaction to medical models, pathologization of eating disorders. I see it also as a revolutionary identity, because by adhering to the cultural femininity in such an overdetermined fashion through such culturally deplorable manner, they're essentially creating a new cultural formation. The movement is based entirely around a group of women advocating for their right to have complete control over their own bodies and supporting each other in an effort that is not only taboo in our society, it's considered a mental disorder. So these women are rewriting the victim frame of women with eating disorders. Next slide. Pro-anemia is also in defiance of capitalist culture. Pro-anemia members are taking what has already been sold to them by capitalist culture and creating something disobedient. So capitalism requires docile bodies, and these women are anything but docile bodies. Pro-ana is potentially a very powerful revolutionary project because capitalism will take revolutionary products and co-opt it and sell it back to people. And I don't think that pro-anemia can be co-opted because it's such a taboo, intense thing that I don't think it could survive being sold back. And so I don't think pro-ana is dangerous for encouraging eating disorders. I think it's dangerous because as a cultural resistance movement, they're holding many different strings that make up the fabric of our modern society. With a few small adjustments like decentering the individual, I think the women of pro-anemia movement hold the power to unravel most of the fabric in our society. Next slide. So understanding pro anemia websites as a capitalist skill, we may begin to understand that the treatment of eating disorders may not necessarily lie in the resolution of each individual case, but in the examination of our cultural paradigm surrounding race, class, and femininity. This is a site of contradiction that has the revolutionary potential to overthrow the dialectical relationship of capitalism and misogyny that keep women in a subordinate position in our society. These young women have already proved to us their great power and intelligence. What would happen if this was funneled into a political project aimed at breaking down the gender binary? What could happen if we engage these women in a dialogue about their needs, their future, engage with them as experts of their own experience? I suspect that we would see a shift in the way that women articulate their strength and intelligence. Cultural movements are the birthplace of political movements. We need to engage these women as active allies in our work for social justice and not theorize about them as unknowing victims. So there's a lot of theories and treatments addressing eating disorders, but clearly they're not working as we see numbers of eating disorders rise every year. What I've done is change the way we're framing the issue. I believe we need to reframe the way we theorize about eating disorders and their connection with capitalist culture and misogyny. We're still faulting the individual. We need to see the collective power and the revolutionary potential of teaching young women to think critically about the impact of capitalism and misogyny within their personal struggle. Teach women that it's powerful to come together. And so in practicing this week, I was really terrified to stand up here today. And I convinced myself that I'm not smart enough to present this theory, that this theory isn't intelligent, that I'm a fraud, and most of all, that I'm flawed because my eating disordered experience can't be placed neatly in my past. Just got nervous. So I caught myself worrying that I wasn't skinny enough to give this presentation. And so how absurd that the very subject of my thesis is so ingrained in my own thought process that it almost prevented me from presenting this theory. And so this alone proves to me that this is powerful and meaningful work that needs to be addressed in a collective and critical manner. We need to understand that this issue profoundly affects individual women's lives, yet it's an issue that needs to be addressed collectively, but also through but also individually through a collective lens.
Well, I was wondering how you would respond to the idea that capitalism is constantly trying to subvert this whole idea through the use of images, right? Like, how would you read that? And I mean, I see what you're saying in terms of it being one of the tougher types of things to co-op, but capitalism is a resilient system, and so as it has proven. So I mean, what do you think about that in terms of that attempt at co-optation?
I don't know.
a couple of slides ago.
You're saying like a couple slides ago she was showing the like pictures from the website,
mm-hmm.
and saying that it's really hard to co-opt these images, but you're saying that, are you sure about that?
Well, no. I mean, the part that I absolutely agree with is I think this would be one of the harder things for capitalism to co-opt. But I mean, if you look at the deluge of images that sort of center around, I mean, I guess what you would call emaciated bodies, from the first world, which I think is very different than the deluge of images that we get of emaciated bodies from like war zones or the third world, right? Like, I mean, how do you see this really pushing back against that?
I
instead of fitting in?
Yeah. Instead, I mean, how does it keep itself from getting co-opted?
I think it's more the thing that's so specific with these websites are the list of skills that are needed to do that, right? I mean, maybe, like, in that way, like, capitalism is not just, like, you should be this skinny. Like, if capitalism were to co-opt it, it would have to be to that extent of these websites. And I think that's what Laura's saying, like, that can't happen with capitalism. It wouldn't be successful because those kinds of things are so specific.
They're so overt.
Yeah, as I understand the argument, Laura's arguing that capitalism can't make people want to buy suicide, right? Can't make people want to buy beauty as death.
Yeah,
because they invented the emaciated. Right. You know, that's not something they co-opted from ProAnna website.
Right.
That's what ProAnna website.
Well, no, I totally get that. That's what I'm saying. I mean, that's
because I think what I'm doing, what I see it as, is that ProAnna is taking what is already sold to them
mm-hmm.
and turning it into something, like doing it so well that they're almost like outgrowing.
That they're co-opting it.
They're taking what has been sold to them and doing it so, so well.
Yeah.
That I don't think it can be resold back.
Because
in any like.
Well, it also seems to fit the difference between the imagery and the language, because I think the imagery, you know, in the capitalist system is making the same statements as that those statements that you were showing from the websites, but it comes out really differently in words than it does in pictures, and so it has this really different impact. It seems like when you like describe it verbally, it's much more frightening and much more it hits you different.
Yeah.
It seems like that's something that's really powerful about what they're saying.
I mean, I just wanted to say thank you because I've never heard of these term limits before, and I feel like I've experienced this. Like this whole revolutionary, reactionary thing, it was like, I'm going to starve myself and I'm going to let you know. And when I would tell boys about it, you know, they'd be like, why aren't you eating lunch? I'm like, because I don't deserve to eat lunch. And they'd be like, well, why? That's stupid. And I was like, because you told me I was fat. I'm just doing what you want me to do. Mm-hmm. So it is an act of rebellion, you know, and you're just going to that extreme. Like, oh, you tell me I need to be skinny like Beyonce. Well, that's fine. I'll just keep starving myself until I look like her. You know what I mean? It's sort of that thing of like your parents telling you, go to your room, and then you just stay in there for days.
I'm just curious about the people who are promoting this. Is it their way of, because they have been such, I don't want to say, they must think that they're successful as hell. They're skinny and...
Most of the young women that make these websites aren't actually skinny. Those aren't pictures of them. They're usually women or young women that are overweight.
So how are they benefiting from this?
Because they think that they're supporting each other in what they see that they want to do, which becomes skinny.
Yeah, I'm a father of a 14-year-old girl, and it's scared me to death.
I was gonna say kind of the same thing. Like, I'm a mother of two young girls, and my older daughter's 9, and kind of on the cusp of all that preteen stuff, and for her to stumble on a website like this would frighten me, you know, because I'm still trying to navigate the language with her, and how do I explain these things in a way that she stays empowered and healthy through it all, because, you know, there's a lot of information out there, and you want to make sure that she's already got the correct information so she can make good choices.
I'm curious about what you think. I'm sort of intrigued by the fact that capitalism wins no matter what, because they've got, they're presenting these, no, I know they don't, we're going to fight this, right? But they're presenting the images that, the emaciated images, that's what we should do. But then they're also selling the diet products to get you there. They're also presenting the images of obesity, selling McDonald's and selling all of that. And then they're also presenting the images that say you can't do that. And then there's this whole movement about, we should shame fat people now. That's the way to resolve this, the way we've shamed smokers. We'll just resolve it by, you know, and so it's like, it's almost, they're coming at us every single direction. with whatever you're doing, it's wrong, and we have something to sell you that will fix it.
Mm-hmm. You know? I guess as I see it, the...
Could we think about that, Laura?
No, go ahead.
It's okay.
I think that the piece that's, one of the pieces that's so important about Laura's analysis is the focus on this as labor, as a form of labor, and that it's not, yes, we are live under conditions of, like, you know, there's an interactive media scape, and we all are subjected to it, right? And we can react to it one way or another way, right? And it's not that surprising that interactive of one way people respond to it, right? But that if you look at it through this other lens where you see, oh my gosh, there's like thousands and thousands of young men on the internet sharing skills with each other, really hard skills, right? Like, these are really hard things to do, right? Overcome your desire for food, that's really hard, right? And it's an act of power, right? California prisoner hunger strikers, right? Refusing food because that's in a kind of incredibly oppressive context, right, where they're encaged in your body as a woman, in a cell as a prisoner, right? That you are creating an act of taking back control of what that produces. And in this case, it is, you know, I don't think they have a transformative vision of the future, as Laura has explained, right, that it's about, it's still individualized, right? It's still competitive with each other. But yet at the same time, you can also see it be like this big, you know, project or movement of women who are sharing skills and practicing this powerful set of skills that could be repurposed towards something truly challenging, right? Like, truly.
Does that make sense? Mm-hmm.
Or towards something healthy.
Yeah. I think it's, I just wanted to comment on that. You spoke about the, like, the potential of this being a revolutionary, like, power structure, and the sharing of skills, and but I'm a little curious about if you see this having potentially dangerous implications, if that was to be, like, reinforced, or, like, reinforcing things that necessarily wouldn't be, I don't know if I'm totally off base with this, but.
Yeah, what I'm thinking is, like, all of these women hold so much power because they understand cultural femininity so much that if there was an added analysis of like how silly the gender binary is, that they could collectively change all of that because there's so many women, you know.
Yeah.
So I don't. So yes, I think that this is like very destructive means through which to do this. But I also think that the amount of women working together right now is really powerful.
Do you see a way that that could be sort of moved in the direction of, for example, having an analysis of the gender binary built into this, or another direction similar?
Theoretically. Yeah.
I have a lot of different ideas and thoughts, but I guess in terms of what would be appropriate for this setting, I used to work in a treatment center for eating disorders, and we talked a lot about the larger systemic issues. I really like the way you address sort of capitalism. As you're focusing on in terms of labor, kind of what I'm gathering, it seems almost in a way like they formed a union, right? This is a labor union. And so looking at it that way, what could be done? What are their terms? But what are other labor unions of this sort as women that aren't ones that have a creed that says, I'm worthless, I should hate myself, and I don't deserve to live? You know, how can you take maybe some of the lessons from this labor union, but put them in other places? I think of a group, just a simple one that comes to my mind, of Birth Without Fear, that I follow on Facebook, and it shows a lot of women who try to really celebrate their body after it's been very mangled, right? After birth, it's very large and lots of stretch marks, and saying, doesn't this also mean that I'm beautiful? And so what can we do to form other unions? How can we have, you know, pro throwaway of scales, pro love your body, I mean, some of those other movements, and what, you know, can we put those different women movements side by side? We also have women labor unions that don't analyze our
great. Anyway, but also really good.
I mean, just off of that, really quickly, has anyone done any research on these women and what, like, how many of them are actually having children and how many are willing to not go through that experience because they don't want to, you know, gain weight from pregnancy? That's an easy question on this
one. I know a lot of celebrities do, right? They don't have
I do know that statistically, you have, if you're anorexic and you know even if you're overweight and you're doing the pro ana thing, it's very hard to conceive. So you would, I don't you know whether it's conscious choice or not, just because of the malnourishment.
Yeah, I feel like that's one of those bars of like if I can get that skinny to where I'm not even menstruating, I'm solid.
One thing that feels really clear to me is that this issue desperately needs a reframe. So I feel like what the ground that you're moving into in challenging the frame, the sort of like two-dimensional frame that exists around women's bodies and dysmorphia and eating disorders, needs to be thought of differently because the frame we're working with all these generations, literally now, it's not actually changing the situation, you know? And it's like my own puberty, you know, my experience of my own puberty feels a lot like the experience of puberty of girls and women today. It's insane that this thing continues to reproduce itself in every generation under different economic situations. And so what I see you doing here is looking to reframe by actually listening to women who are posting themselves and their own relationship to this on line, which is something that I think is new. You know, the actual, it's complicated, and I don't know if I personally feel convinced about your argument, but what I feel is that you're breaking into territory that really needs to be broken into, and it's kind of threatening and scary to actually, and realizing, to listen to women who are saying things that they're not supposed to be saying, you know, in the category that they've been positioned, right, as victims of some of capitalism in society. So, you know,
it's cool. So is that kind of your, one of your main things, though, is saying their approach is not that we're victims, but we are rebels, we're revolutionaries.
That they're recreating themselves as not docile. That they're not, that they're doing something that, yeah, that they're not supposed to be doing, essentially, and that they're being pathologized for.
And I still, maybe I asked the question poorly, but I still have the same question that I think goes to what Mary's saying. If this keeps coming back, if this is what keeps being presented generation after generation, there's something in what you're saying about stepping forward as a laborer, as a revolutionary, saying, we are going to resist this, we're saying, we are taking dominion over this. That has to include being prepared for consumerism is going to come around with, oh, then we can top that. Because whatever we do, there is that presentation then of that other layer. So I like your argument, as you know, and I think that the question that I still have is, how do we add into it that awareness that then there'll be the flip. There'll be something that's presented that sort of benefits from wherever we go. There'll be something that can be sold to us that can benefit that. You know what I mean? We can talk more because I know we're at the end of time, but it's an interesting question about if it is what keeps coming back around, and if there is something on both ends, then how do we take that power you're describing and use it in a way to be one ahead, be a step ahead of that? Mm-hmm. It's just a question. Wow.